everyone. Today I'm going to talk about phylogenetics. So I'll start by just defining the object of interest, which is a phylogenetic tree. I'll remind you that there's two important aspects here. There's the discrete structure that describes the branching of lineages. So here they might be fish species. And there's also a continuous story, which has to do with these branch lengths. So the longer the branch, the more evolution that's happened along that branch. Oh, great, a pointer. That's rather small. So the goal of phylogenetics is to take a collection of DNA sequences from some extant evolving objects, here again fish, and then the goal is to infer a phylogenetic tree. So then the DNA sequences are usually between hundreds to tens of thousands of base pairs long. So today, our goal is to talk about how we can do efficient Bayesian inference of phylogenetic trees. So to motivate this, in my group, we're very interested in the within-host development of antibodies. If you don't know about this, it's a truly amazing story. The antibodies evolve within you in order to bind antigen. And this is important for vaccine design. So one can use phylogenetics to take a bunch of sequences that we've sequenced from an individual, and we're interested in what is the evolutionary process that led to a given antibody. So we can do sort of ancestral sequence reconstruction, and for vaccine design, we really care about what this ancestral state for this this antibody was, because that's what the vaccine is going to be interacting with. So it's common in this field right now of rational vaccine design to take one best tree and run with it. But that's a really bad idea. In our work and on many data sets, we've seen that the optimality surface looks more like this, where we have if we imagine this is the collection of phylogenetic trees and this is the fit to the data, well, yes, there is one best tree, but there's another region of tree space that's just as good. And if we ignore that, we're really not doing a good job of our statistics or machine learning. So of course what we want is lots of trees and their probabilities of being correct. So this is called Bayesian phylogenetics, which is a topic that I love very deeply. So Bayesian phylogenetics, you have some data that you are conditioning on, you're trying to evaluate a probability distribution on the trees. So just as this is our classic Bayes rule setup, where we have our posterior, which is proportional to our likelihood times our prior. The likelihood is fast to evaluate under simple models. I'd love to talk about more complex models at some point in the future, but not for today. However, there's this issue, which is just there's a lot of trees. I guess this got cut off, but it says, ouch, because there's a super exponential number of trees, and so this is a very, very large model space, and we can't do something stupid, like evaluate every possible phylogenetic tree. And this leads people like Michael Betancourt to say, like, basically Bayesian phylogenetics is not possible. Well, let's see why he might say that. So, but first, let's say, what do people do now? So the current process is random walk Markov chain Monte Carlo, with these local rearrangements. And these local rearrangements cut off a section of the tree, move it somewhere else, and then re-glue it, and that's one move. That's sort of one proposal for your phylogenetic MCMC. Literally, current Bayesian software is random walk Markov chain Monte Carlo. I mean, there's hundreds of thousands of citations for these software packages that implement these things. And they're really sort of grinding to a halt as we get more and more data. So a new approach is needed. And so in my group, 5 years ago, I said, we're going to take this on and really try to do better. So we systematically tried all the new stuff, all the new cool shiny toys. So including online sequential Monte Carlo, Hamiltonian Monte Carlo. We figured out a way to extend Hamiltonian Monte Carlo so it doesn't just look at continuous spaces, but a combination of discrete and continuous spaces. Fast marginal likelihood and systematic local search. And all these things work to some extent, but they weren't really the big advance that we needed. And I really think that variational inference is truly the advance that was going to make the next generation of Bayesian phylogenetics possible. So just to remind you, variational Bayes, if we have a posterior of interest and we do it with MCMC, we're trying to sample underneath this posterior. For variational inference, the idea is that you fit a variational distribution to it. So Here, if we in our toy example, we might have just one dimension. Our variational approximation might just be a normal distribution, and these parameters phi are just the mean and the variance of this normal. And we're going to be fitting this normal to our unknown posterior. In particular, minimizing this KL divergence. But phylogenetics is crazy, right? It's this combination of discrete and continuous variables. So how are we going to do that? And so how can we do gradient ascent on phylogenetic posteriors? We went back to some older work that developed this thing called the conditional clade distribution. So the conditional clade distribution, and actually, if you're checking your email, this is the time when you should start paying attention, because this is the crux. So the idea of the conditional clade distribution is that if we're going down the tree and we encounter a situation where we know there's these leaves we know are below us, what is the probability that the next branching event is going to be something we specify? So for instance, we might be coming down the tree and we say, oh, okay, below us are the mammals. What is the probability that the monotremes are the next thing to branch off, like the platypus, and then this is sort of the non-monotreme mammals? So this is a probability distribution, and this is going to this sort of thing is going to form our variational approximation for phylogenetic posterior distributions. And the parameters of this distribution are just the conditional probabilities here. We're just looking at a categorical distribution conditioned on some subgroup of leaves. So now if I've given you such a conditional distribution, and then you come to me with a tree, and you ask, what is the probability of this tree under my variational approximation? I'm just going to break it down. So first we're going to have, what is the probability of this first partition? What is the probability of this second thing? So of this second split conditioned on this. So this came from over here. We condition on it, and then what is the probability that C is the next thing to branch off? And then conditioned on DEF, what is the probability that D is the next thing to branch off? And so this gives us a way of evaluating. If I tell you all these conditional distributions, I can tell you what's the probability of this full phylogenetic tree. So how well does this work? So what we're going to do is we're going to look at basically how well this model approximates. So let's imagine in our mind we have our really big space of probability distributions on phylogenetic tree structures. And so it's R to the number of possible tree structures. It's the simplex, but let's just think about the real space. And we have our sort of approximating model space. So we're interested in how closely can we approximate an actual phylogenetic posterior with this conditional distribution, which is an approximation. It turns out not very well. So it's really not sufficiently complex. So you can see that if we look on a plot like this, where this is the ground truth and this is our estimated probability using this approximation, there's a lot of scatter around the xy axis. So this is really not good enough. So I talked to my postdoc, Ching Zhang, about this, and he developed this beautiful approximation. He had a NIPS paper last year, NRIPS paper, and I encourage you to read about it. It's really beautiful, but all we actually really needed to do was increase the complexity of our conditioning just a little bit. So before, I hope you remember that we were conditioning on U. Now we're conditioning on U with V, another group of organisms, as sister. So now it's the same thing. We're quite curious about how U splits apart into U1 and U2, but we have some more information. And the same thing happens again. I won't repeat the whole thing, but just see that what's going on is here we're conditioning on C being the sister, and we're interested in how DEF splits apart. And this is informative because maybe C and D are similar in some way, and this can give us more rich posterior distributions. And this has a much better scatter on the XY axis. I mean, some people, when I give this talk, give me hassle about this, but this is a log scale, right? I mean, we're doing quite well. And this is in the NRIPS paper last year. We showed that fitting this variational distribution improves MCMC posterior estimates in the sense that if we take an MCMC posterior, we fit this variational distribution, that's actually closer to the true truth than just using the MCMC posterior estimates directly. So it's sort of like this amazing smoother that shares information. So now we sort of have the ingredients we need. We have a variational approximation to tree structure, and then we combine that with a variational approximation of the branch lengths. So I'm not going to go into this. This is sort of beautiful work, but let's just assume that we've done that. And now we have everything we need to do variational inference in phylogenetics. And so this is, again, our sort of cartoon where you have our variational distribution. We sample underneath that variational distribution that allows us to form a gradient, and then we just take gradient steps towards the true posterior distribution. I would pause for questions, but I'm at a limited time budget. Anyway, I'm not going to really show a lot of results here, but this is an example result that shows that the variational inference is converging to the ground truth more quickly than MCMC. So this is just with a proof of concept Python implementation. I personally am writing a ton of C++ right now, because I really care about this project. And what we want to do is sort of make a module that you can access from Python, where you can express interesting parts of your model in Python, but let the C++ do the phylogenetic computations quickly. So I want to say, where are we going here? The amazing thing about this is, in contrast to MCMC, we get models that can be adapted. So if you change your model a little bit with MCMC, you have to start over. If you use variational inference, you can take your existing approximation and just do a few adaptation steps. And that's really important for model comparison. There's also this sort of old line of work from the late 90s where people had this idea, well, instead of computing an entire phylogenetic tree at once, what we should do is sort of cut it up into subregions, build trees on those subregions, and then glue them back together. And we are developing Bayesian methods to do this. I hope to submit this to NeurIPS next year. Also, we're developing online methods where you have your existing posterior, you get some additional sequence data, and you do something so that you get a posterior on all of your leaves. So hopefully that gives you a flavor of what we're doing. This is the group that worked on this, and if you're interested in working on this, let me know. Thank you very much. That's an awesome extension. I mean, I want to remind you that we're sort of like taking on a fairly big project already, like completely turning the way that people do Bayesian inference in the single gene case on its head. But yes, there's all sorts of things that we could do.
Like 2 years, maybe?
I'm coding with the idea of a decade in mind. Like, I really care about this project. I wish the NIH cared as much as I did, but that's another story. There's another question over there. Yes. Yes, absolutely. So where's the rug that I swept all that stuff underneath? So this is an exponentially large parameter space a priori. But I remind you that the phylogenetic parameter space is sort of super exponential. And we are able to do phylogenetics. I mean, it's kind of slowing down as we get more sequences. So the way that we do this is we actually come up with a heuristic way of cutting down the initial parameter set so that we only look at these conditional distributions in such a way, like for ones that should be non-zero. So that's an ongoing part of our research, like how can we do the best job of doing that, and how can we make this dynamic? But yes, that's something that's an issue.